Thank you. So now we move on to the next item on the agenda, which are the deputations by appointment. So are they ready to go?
Yes, Leanne, we've just let Jared True in from the waiting room.
That's great. Okay, so the first deputation that we're receiving on the item 11, review of gambling and TAB venues policy, is Jared True, who's representing the Gaming Machine Association of New Zealand. Welcome, Jared. You'll need to unmute.
All right, thank you for the opportunity to speak this morning. I represent the Gaming Machine Association, which represents the vast majority of gaming machine societies. We're asking that you consider putting the gambling venue policy out for consultation so we can get some community feedback and stakeholder feedback regarding a couple of options. One, including a relocation provision in the policy, and two, looking at whether it's now time to look at replacing the sinking lid with a cap at current numbers. The most important issue is including a relocation provision. A relocation, first and foremost, is a harm minimisation tool. It enables venues to move out of undesirable areas, such as high deprivation areas or residential areas, into more suitable areas, such as the central business districts. Not allowing relocation just simply entrenches the venues in the undesirable locations. Having a relocation provision is also fair to local business owners. Enables a business to be restored following a fire, natural disaster, or in the event of public works acquisition. Relocation also enables a venue to move out of earthquake-prone buildings, enables a venue such as a large tavern or a large club to move out of a large block of land to a smaller, more modern, smaller premise, free up that large block of land for residential housing, for example. Also enables our venues to move if the landlord's demanding unreasonable terms or unreasonable rentals. Importantly, it also enables some of our venues to move a short distance across the road or next door to new, modern, refurbished premises. The very first venue that took advantage of the relocation provisions was a venue in Hamilton called the Tarapa Tavern. The left is the old venue, on the right is the new venue. The venue was able to relocate a short distance, take its 18 gaming machines with it. It was therefore economically viable for that operator to spend $3 million and improve, upgrade and build the new tavern, which is a fantastic asset for the city. Relocation is common. Over 55 councils now have some form of relocation provision in place. Just in relation to now whether we have a cap or a sinking lid, given the very low problem gambling rate, the benefits that come from the local machines, it's now appropriate to consider replacing the sinking lid with a cap at current numbers. Problem gambling rate's very, very low. It's only 0.2% of the adult population, and that's in relation to all forms of gambling, not just simply gaming machine gambling. There's no link between gaming machine numbers and problem gambling rates. Over the last 10 years, 25% of our machines throughout New Zealand have been removed. Over 4,600 machines have gone. However, in the same 10-year period, the problem gambling rate has stayed the same. It's, of course, considerable benefit from having the local machines. Community funding is generated from the machines. Approximately $25 to $33 million each year goes to local organisations. That funding is extremely valuable and not able to be replaced. And, of course, playing on the machines is a form of entertainment. 67% of us gamble at least once a year. And the machines, importantly, in the current climate, we pay our venue operators to host our machines and to supervise the players on the machines. And that locally is approximately $12 million each year. And that is important funding for the hospitality businesses. Retaining the sinking lid and not allowing relocation is unlikely to reduce problem gambling, but will accelerate the growth of gambling offshore on online providers. All the games that are on our current game machines can be played on your phone or on your tablet within a matter of seconds. In 2017, Cabinet put together a paper and looked at the growth of online gambling. That paper indicated back then that over $300 million of money was being spent on offshore providers. TAB New Zealand, approximately 60% of all their turnover is now through the tablets or your phone, through their online devices. And it's growing exponentially between 12 and 20% per year. And of course, offshore online-based gambling is undesirable. There's no local grant money that comes from that, no local employment, and no taxes generated for the New Zealand government, no harm minimisation regulations or controls. There's very large prizes and there's frequent inducements to gamble. Certainly welcome any questions.
Thank you. It's difficult to control all my buttons here. Look, you had a number of gaming machines that had been reduced over the period of time, but you didn't have a breakdown for Christchurch. Have you got that?
No, I haven't got the exact figures for how many machines that you've lost over the last 10 years. I know we lost a significant amount of venues, about 11 venues from memory, immediately after the earthquakes.
Mm. Mm. And you think it would be helpful to go out for consultation, even though obviously, you know, recognising the other ones, the other representations that we'll receive, that there will be a desire to perhaps open up some of the other issues, perhaps not in the same direction as you would like to
see. I think it's appropriate as part of the democratic process to now take stead with what the community views are and the stakeholder views are, and particularly the funding that's received from the machines, to take stead of what the people that receive the funding, what their views are, learn what the value that they've achieved from those. The policy hasn't been reviewed now for probably 9 years. Certainly a tweak, along with, even if you were to retain the sinking lid but introduce a relocation provision, and even if that relocation provision was quite limited, which said we will only allow venues to relocate out of residential areas or out of high deprivation areas to more appropriate areas, I think there's some tweaks in there that you could make as part of that policy which would improve it from both a commercials perspective and a harm minimisation perspective.
Yeah, and I do actually know an example of that particular relocation issue, which actually could have seen a gambling machine taken out of the suburb of Shirley and put into Addington Raceway. So I know exactly what you're talking about.
That would be something that would exactly happen. That Addington Raceway issue is still a live issue.
Tim.
Yeah, thank you. Jared, you said that although there has been a reduction in machines, there hasn't been a reduction in problem gambling. Do you put that down to the issue of online gambling, and especially with the... Do you have any figures on the growth of the online gambling from overseas? Is money going out?
I think that's part of the issue. If you look at the graphs where you see the gaming machine numbers going down, and then you look at the graphs of online gambling going up, you know, one's clearly going up and one's clearly going down. But you've got the issue of problem gamblers are people that are addicted to gambling. There will always be some form of gambling venue that they'll be able to find in Christchurch City. So when you limit the policy and limit new venues, you're limiting recreational players. You're not stopping those people that are addicted to gambling. Mm. You've got a casino right in the heart of your city with hundreds of gaming machines. People are always going to be able to find a gaming machine to play if they're addicted to gaming.
But I guess the difference is if it is in council or in city or in country, there is an amount of tax taken from that, which then could be put and does in some respects gets put into dealing or helping with problem gambling. But if it's overseas, the tax revenue is not there. Do you have an idea of the tax revenue that's being lost?
The tax revenue from our machines is over $1 million a day. Okay. And we also fund the problem gambling levy, which pays for all the treatment providers. It pays for the face-to-face services, the helpline, problem gambling research. And that's currently $20 million a year, soon to go up to about $22 million a year.
Thank you very much.
None of the offshore providers or the online providers make any contribution by way of taxes or to that problem gambling levy.
Yep. Thank you very much.
Look, Jared, thank you very much for your presentation. I think you've given all of us some food for thought for when we consider item 11. So it's very much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, the next one is Kirsty Kang, Policy and Public Health Advisor, and Andre Proud, is it? Proud? I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, from the PGF group, the Problem Gambling Foundation group.
You're probably right behind you.
Okay.
Okay.
We're in. I'll just go, someone's sharing screen.
Kia ora.
Hey, morena. We're just waiting.
Sorry. Phil, are you going to go first? Sorry, we just got...
Gerhard's probably leading the presentation. Otherwise, we get the end. Thank you. How are you, Leanne?
I'm good.
Good, good. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too.
It's been a few years.
Even if it is at a distance.
Yeah. Shall I just give a wee intro to myself while we're waiting for that?
Sorry. Yes, please. Far away.
Well, te lau whalawa, kia ora koutou. Thank you for the mahi that you're doing in these extraordinary times. Unbelievable. My name is Phil Siatanga. I've been in the addiction field for 30 years. I work with Mapi Maia as a counsellor, and so we're a Pacific provider. I've been in this community for 20 years, and most of my mahi, most of the clients that I work with are Māori and Pacific.
Hello, can anyone hear me?
Oh, go ahead, has arrived, thank you.
Sorry, I can't turn on my video, it says host has stopped it, but... I mean, it's okay, I can just speak.
The host can start it again for you, but I'm now confused because I've got an order of play here where I had Kirsty Kang, then Paul Barrett, and then Mapu Maia.
Oh,
so,
okay.
Okay, then we can go first.
So the PGF group was the first one, and that's the presentation that I have in front of me. So shall we start with that one?
Sure.
Thanks, Kirsty.
Tēnā koutou katoa. Thank you to the Mayor and the councillors for the opportunity to comment on PGF Group's position regarding Christchurch City Council's Class 4 gambling and TAB venues policy. My name is Kirsty Kang, and I'm the Manager of Policy and Public Health at PGF Group. And I'm also joined by my colleague, Andre Frood, who is the Director of Marketing and Communications. Just a little background about PGF Group. We provide nationwide gambling harm minimization and prevention services, and we also have an office based in Christchurch. Firstly, we'd like to commend Christchurch City Council for having a sinking-led approach in place for the past 17 years. The council has a really important part to play in helping to ensure the objectives of the Gambling Act are achieved. And we would like to remind that the primary intent of this policy is to reduce gambling accessibility in order to prevent and minimise harm. And so we support the recommendation to council of retaining the current sinking-led policy with no relocations permitted. A sinking-led policy is currently still the best policy available to reduce harm. Next slide, please. Much of the research quoted in an attempt to denounce the efficacy of a sinking lid is outdated, and findings from a new study counters assertions made by the Class 4 gambling industry. AUT's New Zealand Work Research Institute released a report aimed at understanding the impact of public policy interventions on problem gambling in New Zealand. And this report explored the impact of absolute caps, per capita caps, and sinking lid policies on the number of machines and venues and the level of machine spending. And key findings from this study was that one, sinking lid policies are one of the most effective policies at reducing machine spending. and two, those TLAs who adopted restrictions above and beyond those mandated by the Gambling Act experience less gambling harm than those TLAs who have not. We appreciate that this council considers the health and well-being of the community to be of utmost importance. And we also acknowledge that a sinking lid policy does not go far enough, and further efforts can be made on top of a sinking lid policy. So more than 50% of all Class 4 poker machines are located in the most deprived communities in New Zealand. And DIA data shows that as at 31st of December 2020, exactly 50% of Class 4 gambling venues in Christchurch are located in decile 7 to 10 communities. So at whatever data point we use, it is reasonable to conclude that a majority of the money being paid out by the trusts and societies who are simply clearing houses for gambling losses is coming from the poorest New Zealanders. Next slide, please. We would like to reiterate that it is important to consider that all gambling is not the same. Class 4 gambling, pokies and pubs, clubs and TABs is characterised as high risk, high turnover gambling, and is the most harmful form of gambling in New Zealand. Pokies are highly addictive and have been specifically designed to be very absorbing and encourage people to participate in continuous gambling. Importantly, the Health and Lifestyle Survey of 2016 found that gambling harm is experienced disproportionately by those living in areas with a high New Zealand Deprivation Index score. And they were 4.5 times more as likely to experience gambling-related arguments or money problems due to gambling. Māori and Pacific peoples were also more than twice as likely to experience moderate to severe gambling harm than European and other populations. So while the prevalence of risky gambling is relatively low at a population level, it should be noted that the prevalence of gambling harm is high amongst those who gamble regularly. And research tells us that almost half, or 49%, of people who gamble on pokies in pubs and clubs at least monthly were found to be at risk. Next slide, please. In 2020, according to the Ministry of Health, 578 clients were assisted in Christchurch, and this accounted for 13% of all clients nationally. And when looking at national figures, almost half of those clients seen by problem gambling service providers such as ourselves are to do with Class 4 gambling. And the remaining 41% of clients are made up of lotto, sports betting, casino table games, and online gambling. But by far, Class 4 gambling is what we see as having the most impact on New Zealanders. And it also is important to understand that the presentation numbers are not an accurate measure of the total harm that is in the community, but it is just an indicator of which forms are most harmful. Next slide, please. Given this, we recommend to Council to one, vote to retain the current sinking lid policy with no relocations for Christchurch City. A sinking lid policy is still the best policy we currently have to minimise the harm from gambling, and it shows that the Council supports the well-being for the community. We also acknowledge that sinking lid policies alone cannot address the sheer extent of problem gambling, and research suggests that TLAs who adopt restrictions above and beyond mandated by the Gambling Act experience less gambling harm than those TLAs who do not. Therefore, our second recommendation is strongly urging the Council to take a step further and advocate to central government to review the Class 4 gambling funding system, as Wellington City Council recently voted to do as part of their gambling venue policy review. There is growing support from local councils who are advocating to government about the urgent need to replace Class 4 funding with transparent, sustainable and ethical funding for the community groups. And we urge Christchurch City Council to explore this option as well. We appreciate that many community and sports groups depend on funding from Class 4 trusts, but we also cannot ignore the unethical and inequitable nature of that funding model. The Class 4 funding system has inextricably linked gambling harm with the survival of community groups, sports and services. but this has led to a situation where we must consider whether the benefit of gambling outweighs the harm experienced by those in our communities. And it is our position that irrespective of what proportion of losses is returned, it cannot justify nor undo the harms caused to communities. Next slide, please. And thank you for the opportunity to present today. And if you have any questions, please let us know.
Sorry, thank you. Because I don't have a timer sitting on my desk, it's hard to, I think I'm going to have to turn my own timer on to keep a track of it. Tim.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. With regards to what we heard, with regards to the online overseas gambling compared to the local gambling where it's taxed, etc., and therefore with those that taxed money, it supports the supports you guys and others. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, online gambling, that is currently being reviewed by the Department of Internal Affairs and the government itself. But it's our view that online gambling, it is increasing over the years. However, it's not good for the communities. And Andre, do you want to add some additional facts?
Yeah, if that's okay. Hi, I'm Andre. I just on online gambling, I think, you know, the class four gambling industry often use that as a bit of a distraction because online gambling is not what we're talking about here. However, it is growing, there is no doubt. And unfortunately in New Zealand, we don't have reliable data that I can say to you, well, it's increased by this amount, you know, particularly with lockdowns having happened so recently, we can't rely on any sort of data that we've got at the moment, but there is no doubt that it's growing and it's very much on our radar. And of course, some of it is on offshore sites where, yes, you don't get the return to communities or the tax. The government doesn't get the tax. But having said that, we certainly don't want to be looking at gambling propping up our communities. And this is part of our problem, is that we currently have a situation where we're funding our communities and sports groups from the poorest people in our country. And because so many of these poker machines are in our poorest communities. So, you know, I think the online gambling thing is, yes, it's there, but we still have a significant problem with pokies in our communities. And I think you're about to hear from Paul Barrett, and he will share a story that happened in Christchurch. And it is a tragic story, and it is an example of, you know, the problems that we are seeing all the time with pokies in our communities.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Look, thank you for your presentation and for going to all of that trouble. And we'll just move on to Paul Barrett. And I think he's also supported by you, Andre, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll move on to Paul Barrett. Thank you. And thank you very much, Kirsty, for your presentation.
Hello. Hope you can hear me.
Welcome. Yes.
I'll try and be as concise as I possibly can. In 2018, my father died of a heart attack. A couple of weeks before that, he rang me for some money, about $1,500. I was in the middle of doing the ASB tennis tournament. I was an executive chef there for Sky City. And I couldn't get out of that tournament to go see what was happening. So I sent him the money. And then a week later, he asked for another $1,000. And I said, I couldn't get the money out straight away because I was still in the middle of the tournament. I said this was strange because he had the money from the earthquake for his house, which is about $450,000, was sitting in his bank account. He told me that was stuck in bonds and he couldn't get it out. And probably about 2 weeks later, my dad died of a heart attack. So I rushed down to Christchurch to see my mother and to deal with the aftermath of that. We went to the on the weekend to get some food for my mother, and the bank account, we went to the bank to pay for the food, and it declined. And we found that was strange because it was my dad had a lot of money. And basically we found, we went to the bank on the Monday, and we found out there was about 14 accounts, but only $46 left. And we've got basically 4 years of bank statements. And those 4 years of bank statements, he spent over $480,000. There's about 14 venues that he went to. June this year, we went to the first case in New Zealand, we went to the court in Christchurch. I went to Internal Affairs to, this was about 3 years later. In the first week, I went to Internal Affairs to see what could be done, because I knew this was wrong. Because I worked for Sky City and I knew the policies for gaming and alcohol. And there's a duty of harm, protection of the person that goes to that those venues. Now, 2 years along, I went to the government and wrote a letter to say, hey, what's going on? Why is this case being delayed? Because over time, people's memory goes and people move on. But at least in 3 years, the court was heard. And it was a weak, case. And they wanted only charge one of the venues. I said, well, okay, you're the experts. Let's do that. He spent $86,000 at that venue. That's not the whole picture. He spent about $500,000 plus because there was no money going back in. The devastation to my mother, the family, left with nothing, having to sell all our possessions to make sure that my mum had some money. But also then the case has been chucked out in 2 days because the policies to protect the people that are actually gambling aren't there. Now, the reason why I did this is so it couldn't happen to anybody else. It's still frustrating, it's still angry, all those sort of things, but to get the silver lining out of it, this is not about the money, this is about making sure that it doesn't happen to any other family. And it's been, well, I don't want to keep on doing this forever because it's been 3 years already. It's about trying to make it better for somebody else, making sure it doesn't happen to this, any other family. Probably that's the short version. I could probably go on for longer, but this is probably as much as I can do.
That's an incredibly powerful presentation, Paul. I mean, you know, I think you've struck a chord with everyone. The aftermath of addiction is almost inevitably tragic, and the circumstances you described are certainly that. Why do you have to keep doing this at every single council meeting around the country, though? I mean, there are 67 territorial authorities. Why can't central government take control of this particular thing? You know, there are other things they'd like to take control of that we do, but I just wonder whether this is actually the sort of thing that we actually need central government to take a position on.
I did. I went to Internal Affairs on the first week my father died. And they said this is the first case of its kind. We found out the policies aren't strong enough to prosecute anybody. If it was alcohol, they would have lost their license, they would have been fined and in jail. So all I'm trying to do is protect the person that is actually gambling. If we had problem gambling, my dad was a perfect example of that. We didn't know, is it a family? Because he controlled all the finances. But that doesn't make it any excuse that if it was alcohol, I wouldn't even be here. This is gaming. It should be the same sort of policies that protect the person that goes into those venues.
So did you get a response from the Department of Internal Affairs when you asked them, you know, is central government going to provide for an enforceable regime?
I haven't had any response on that sort of. They said they were looking at the policies, but in the 3 years that I went to, nothing has been done to improve that. If the policies have been changed, I wouldn't even be here. I wouldn't even be talking to you. I did it so that it could actually protect any other family or any other person in New Zealand. This is not about me and my family. It's too late for that. I failed my father by not being there for him, but in terms of that, this is about helping other people.
Yeah, No, you haven't failed your father. I think what you've done is describe very intimately just how big an impact this has on families and actually whole communities. So thank you for that. Yanni?
Yeah, thank you. And thank you too for sharing your personal story with us to make us aware of some of the issues. I didn't want the names of the places where the gambling occurred, but what I was interested in, given the previous deputations, was around if there was any sense of the geographic areas that it was happening in. Was it happening across venues across the city, or was it in certain geographic areas that was apparent?
It was in Kaipoi, but he also worked in Northwood, and he did go outside Kaipoi and Northwood areas. It was over Christchurch wide, but mainly in Kaipoi.
But basically,
Kaipoi is actually the Waimakariri District Council.
Yep, so,
I mean, that's the issue about all of the different councils being required to go through this individually, and actually whether this isn't a central response that is required.
Yeah, I guess I was just interested if allowing pokie machines to go from poorer neighbourhoods to wealthier neighbourhoods would solve the issue of problem gambling.
I think, I mean, maybe, if can I throw that one to Andre?
Yes, yeah. I don't think that it would solve the issue of problem gambling, but it would stop some of the impact, the harms that are being caused to the people, you know, who can't afford to be losing that money. I just want to acknowledge Paul. He's bravely spoken out on this. The impact on his family has been nothing short of horrendous. I wanted you to hear it, and I'm glad that Paul has shared it with you, because it did happen in the wider Christchurch area, and because it's an example of, unfortunately, it's not the only story we hear like this. And it also illustrates, you know, the harm that pokies can cause and the ongoing harms to the people who, you know, the families. So thank you, Paul, very much for your bravery and for sharing that story.
Yeah, thank you very much. You know, it is an incredibly powerful submission, so thank you for that today. Thank you. And so perhaps if I now move on to Gerhard Birking, who was originally with us to present the Mapua Maya, and Philip Siatanga as well. Thank you.
Can you hear me, Leanne?
Yes, I can hear you fine. Oh, that's good.
Great, thank you. Tālo Falava, Malu Lele, Gerhard Birking from Mapumaya Services. Today with me, my colleague Phil Siatanga as well. But before we start, I just wanted to quickly acknowledge Paul for sharing your story. Thank you very much for sharing. Members of the council, we thank you for the opportunity to present today on Mapumaya's position regarding Christchurch City's Class 4 gambling policy. We're here to state our argument in favour of a comprehensive sinking lid and explain from a Pasifika lens why it's important for you to support such a policy. Firstly, some background on Mapumaya Services. We're a national Pacific problem gambling service that work to promote and protect the public health of all Pacific peoples living in New Zealand. We have a team of counsellors who work with Pacific families experiencing gambling harm. We meet them in their homes, in our offices, and out in the community. It's in these spaces where we see the harms that pokies are causing. And as you would have gathered from Paul, not just to the gambler, but their families too, all and those close with them, partners, parents, children, friends, and networks. I'm just wanting to focus on Pasifika and pokies in New Zealand and how this can affect those living in Christchurch. Historically, Class 4 gambling pubs and clubs in New Zealand has not benefited Pasifika as a collective. You know, rather, it has stood out as the most harmful gambling mode, as shown by our PGF group data, which indicates
Class 4 gambling to be the most identified primary problem mode for Pacific clients. Between 2010 and 2019, our PGF group data illustrated that each year, Class 4 gambling was the most identified problem gambling mode for Pacific clients who were receiving support under PGF group, including Mapumaya services. In some of these years between 2010 and 2019, it was three times higher than the next ranking mode. Research like AUT's National Gambling Study also points out that across New Zealand, Pacific communities are more likely to live in the areas of higher deprivation, greater opportunities to gamble, and as mentioned by Christy earlier, at least twice as likely to experience moderate to severe gambling harm than those identifying as New Zealand European Pākehā. It's because of these rates, these high rates of harm relating to Class 4 gambling, Mapumaya currently advocate for the strongest regulations possible. when dealing with pokie-related policies, we argue that Class 4 gambling environments are not currently designed to help Pacific families thrive or Pacific communities thrive. Furthermore, it's our position to go further than merely bringing, we feel that a sinking lid is the strongest policy available at the moment. Anecdotally, we can share that many of Mapumaya's clients have caused harm to themselves and their families and others because of poverty-prompted gambling. In these circumstances, Pasifika have turned to gambling as a solution to pre-existing financial hardship, only to lose more and create further harm to themselves. Next slide, please. So this is a map of the Class 4 venues, and the data to provide this map was from the Department of Internal Affairs. So what you see, every red dot is a venue, a Class 4 venue in the Christchurch region. Now, in other cities, what we find is often is clusters or little pockets where you'll find high concentration of venues. Unique thing about Christchurch is there, it seemed to be in every direction. And if you were to use the middle of the map as the center point and create a 10-kilometer radius and do a full circle, everything within that 10-kilometer circle, in that circle would show that each Class 4 venue is within 2 kilometers of another one. And we feel like, furthermore, 50%, as Christy said, 50% of venues are situated in areas of medium-high deprivation. It would suggest that Pacific peoples and other high priority groups in Christchurch City have moderate to high opportunity to gamble, irrespective of where they reside in the city. For these reasons, Mapumaya would urge Christchurch City Council to continue prioritizing the needs of Pacific, as well as other vulnerable groups, high-risk groups, who are disproportionately experiencing gambling related harm, and renew a comprehensive sinking lid policy for this TLA. We submit that Pacific communities are not at fault for living in the wrong geographical area, but that pokie machines are spread inequitably across the country, which in turn place our people at relatively high risk of harm. We don't support the idea of relocation within the policy, as we feel that it will merely be shifting harm from one community to another. In the case of Christchurch, it seems, you know, where would you move the venue? It's already quite saturated enough in the city, in each north, west, east, south. I'm just going to pass it through to my colleague Phil now, and he can speak to share some of his experiences as a councillor working day to day on the front lines with our people.
Oh, Marlo, Gerhard, my apologies for jumping in earlier. But back to due process. Mihi to Paul for sharing. The spillover is often hidden, and I'm one of the few Pacifica councillors in Christchurch working with Pacifica people. And I can't express the amount of suffering that flows through families when they move into pathological gambling lifestyles. It's terrible. So I have a montage of clients running through my head as I think about what are the key features. Nobody wants to be a problem gambler. I think what's sometimes lost is that the incredibly powerful hock of pokies. There's a lot of stuff that in the addiction field we know about, and it is a behavioural addiction that comes with a whole lot of complexities. But by the time that they end up being referred to us, we're seeing a lot of chaos and pain and hurt, and our people are coming from all walks of life. So they may be doing very well professionally. They may be in trades. They could be teachers. They're all family members. And in a small community like Christchurch, as you well know, in the Pacifica space, there are extra barriers to even getting to our door. The shame's incredible. And so we're often working around that whole coexisting problem space. And also the workforce. We don't have and this is well known. I mean, it's right across the mental health sector, issues around workforce supply and demand. So the existence of pathways, the barriers to even getting the help are huge. And this is why we put a great deal of effort into doing public health work and prevention orientated work. But the narrative, I think for me, in this particular context in Christchurch and in this moment under COVID, is that the stresses that people are often trying to escape, which Gerhard alluded to, are being exacerbated. And the financial pressures and that are sitting on people right now, and particularly among our people who don't have huge saving reserves and assets to play with anyway, I'm very concerned. So obviously from my space, the less pokies, the better. And I could say a lot more, but I won't. I think that sort of expresses what I'm most concerned about. And it is pokies. It is pokies in the main that I see our people struggling with. Not because the hookers in terms of our universal physiology is, you know, it can impact on anyone. Are Pacifica people more vulnerable? Yeah, in my experience and my observation. Yeah.
Thank you, Phil.
So thank you.
But thank you very much, Phil. And I'm, it's always really good to hear from somebody who's on the front line of dealing with people who are struggling. I mean, in this regard, the gaming machines are definitely set up to reinforce all of that psychology that you're talking about. You're a winner if you get, you know, a free spin and you're try again. Not you're a loser. You don't get told you're a loser if nothing comes back. So yeah, so very powerful submissions from everyone. Thank you very much. It's come to the end of the time for the deputations on those. So thank you very much for making that time available and presenting to us. Thank you.
Thank you.
And but we've got two more deputations, and they are in relation to item 19, which is in the PX section of the council meeting, the future of organic waste processing in Christchurch. And the first one who's going to present on that is Bailey Perryman. So I'd like to invite you, Bailey, to take over from here. Thank you.
Kia ora koutou, I'm assuming you can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now. That's fine.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you all today. The slides are showing mostly visuals to help you get a picture of what I want to talk about today. For those of you who don't know me, already, I've been active in the community for 10 or so years now as part of growing the local food and urban gardening movement, particularly here in Christchurch, but nationwide. I have a policy and planning background as well, so I understand consents. I understand how you can fail to meet your consent obligations as well. I feel your pain, but I still believe composting is the solution. For us to stick with here as a city, so yeah. Oh, sorry.
Bailey, I don't seem to have your presentation in front of us. Are we able to get some assistance from the team with that?
Apologies. I can see this.
We're just working on that. Sorry. It is on the Big Tin Can Hub as well for councillors to access, but we just seem to be having a technical problem, sorry.
All right, okay. We'll carry on, Bailey, because I've got it up on my screen now.
I just urge you to.
Okay, we'll carry on.
Oh, cool. Bailey. Sorry, I'm just got to mute the screen in the background. There we go. Right. So I'm here representing today a group called 2020 Compost. 2020 stands for the time and space it takes to deal with the volume of materials, organics materials, 20 square meters, 20 cubic meters worth of material, and 20 weeks to process. But really, it's a simple simple solution that we'd like to share with you today that addresses some of the really critical issues around odors that come from composting processes. So what have we been doing? We've been designing, running, and developing community composting trials since April 2020. These are micro-scale setups that sit within permitted activity limits of planning rules as they relate to composting. They are safe, sanitary, and low cost for communities to implement themselves with some initial training. And we have trials active in three locations within suburban Christchurch. The next phase of activations will be in the Otakaro Avon River Corridor in the regeneration area. Bit about how we've actually gone about this. So it's an important moment for composting in Christchurch. It's also an important time to face local food insecurity issues that are rife. And that's the real gem of localized community organic systems, is that they are coupled with basically big as healthy food gardens. What we're talking about is not targeted at replacing the OPP and curbside collections, rather adding a simple, complementary, yet sophisticated localised system that supports the OPP as well as the future of the council's waste minimisation objectives. And a bit more about odours and consents. We've been assessing how the planning rules apply to community composting in the region, throughout the region. And we're in the process of engaging with ECAN to further our journey towards becoming fully compliant. The short of it is there are grey areas, but they're workable. The compost piles themselves are covered and they're not turned. They look like a long black bread loaf. And that could be made a lot prettier, but again, they're pretty much undetectable, and with no offensive or objectionable odours noticeable at the boundary of our existing trial sites. We can easily make low-cost natural inputs that support the composting process to happen without that turning. And technical composting nerdy stuff aside, basically they remain odour-free to within metres of the pile from start to finish. So it fits within suburban Christchurch. The main other main point of difference is that the actual footprint in terms of the square metres of each compost pile only occupies around 1% of the total land area we have access to for the trials. This means that the impacts on the surrounding environment and the residential areas are on a micro level when compared to the OPP, for example. The system can be easily replicated and dispersed geographically, which potentially also localises the transport movements for waste collections and opens options for alternative transport models, such as a trailer towed by an electric bike, which I have done. It's culturally responsive. We have a letter of support from the previous chairman of Maitua Huriri Uranga as well, Arapata Rubin. Like I was saying, the balance of the area is used for marakai, food gardens, as teaching and learning spaces for all ages. We're combining Indigenous biodiversity restoration and there's intergenerational nurturing of connections between whānau, community and land, including whenua of really high cultural significance to Maitahu. So it's a really powerful partnership model. It promotes equity. There are a lot of co-investments already in place. Really, this is a very, very strongly community-based model. There's lots of interest from the knowledge sectors as well. We have support with Mātauranga, with sampling and analysis, environmental compliance, health and safety, all sorts. And also I bring in a research capacity as a PhD scholar, a lot of coordination to that, which is also funded across 3 years. And I'd like to acknowledge the support I get from the university for that and the National Science Challenge. So our offer to council really is to join the partnership. We're ready to take on a new scale and we want to offer the council the opportunity to partner with 2020 Compost to further develop our solution. By investing in community composting, the council can create a complementary system that relieves the pressure from the existing OPP. We can also produce a report compiling the case studies and analysis of the economic feasibility of community composting as an additional option to consider for staff who are going to be investigating the relocation of the OPP. And we'll obviously connect with various knowledge sectors in our community to co-produce this. What we'll do, we can demonstrate, we believe we can demonstrate to council by March 2022, when staff want to come back to you with the options, that there are alternative processing and collection models that are operational now with the potential to support the city region to continue growing the annual diversion rates for organics in the city without requiring the same level of capital investments to upgrade the OPP or the further costs to relocate it in order to achieve the service delivery targets for organics. So our next phase of trials aims to manage approximately 1% of the existing OPP annual tonnage, so 500 tonnes out of 50,000 tonnes a year. We're aiming to gain all the necessary approvals and consents to conduct trials as if the operation were to be ongoing. And at 6 months, we'll be able to determine whether the trials could be adapted to continue rapidly testing the scalability and viability of community composting as an option for managing organics alongside an upgraded OPP. What we need from council? We want you to fund us. It'll be a 50-50 split. Our objective in partnering with council is to like I said, test the economic viability of community composting when it is enabled to operate on a more secure financial basis with more appropriate resourcing. The cost, the other 50%, we can offset through gate receipts for the disposal of commercial vegetable scraps and offer free drop-off of garden organics for the public as well. There's a lot further information detailed in the PDF that I'm hoping is attached to you all and it's accessible, but I can provide more information. So yeah, what I'm asking for, the balance is $215,000 or 1% of the $21.5 million you had budgeted for the OPP upgrades. But we'll be able to spread this across 3 years to continue developing the community composting model for public benefit should the first 6 months prove to continue to be successful. So we're only asking you to commit $35,833 up front. But yeah, why? Our communities need this. We distribute the effects of organic waste management throughout the city region and integrate it where food gardens can be created for the benefit of all communities. And agreeing to do this will return benefits for the city in terms of well-being outcomes beyond the value of waste management and service activities alone. So yeah, Goreira, tēnā koutou katoa. Thank you very much for this opportunity. And yeah, over to you.
Look, thank you very much, Bailey. You've come to the end of your 10 minutes, but I really appreciate all of the, well, I appreciate all the work that you do, actually. I know that councillors do generally. We do know who you are and what you've been up to. So I think you've given us considerable food for thought for later on in the meeting. So thank you very much for your presentation.
Sure. All good.
Thank you. And we've got Tracy McClellan, who's the MP for Banks Peninsula. Kia ora, Tracy, and welcome.
Kia ora, thank you. Thank you for having me. Kia ora koutou katoa. Thank you, Madam Mayor, and fellow councillors, all the councillors here today and staff. Thank you for the opportunity to say a few words. I am happy. Sorry, I've got a notice up on my screen. I am happy to not take the full 10 minutes, but will make myself as concise as possible and more than happy to take some questions should that be relevant. I'm called Tracy McClellan and I hope I'm here in my capacity as the Member of Parliament for Banks Peninsula. The Bromley Living Earth plant is in Christchurch East, but many of the residents or many of the people that are most impacted by this are my constituents, your residents living in Banks Peninsula. I'd like to acknowledge, I think, first and foremost, the work that's been done to date, you know, by councillors, by staff, in an attempt to resolve this long-standing issue. And I'd also like to really acknowledge the Bromley and wider community who for far too long have had to contend with far too much. It's not just the smell from this plant, but also the due recognition that the concerns that they had over a number of years were actually valid. So I want to make three specific points, or emphasise three points, should I say. None of these things should be novel to you, but I'm here in my role as advocating for this community, and these are the three points that we want to be considered. The first is the residents in Bromley are simply fed up. For a long time now, they've had to deal with the unpleasant smell of organic waste disposal wafting from the Living Earth plant on Metro Place into their homes. Earlier this year, ECAN issued council with an abatement notice to stop emitting, quote, offensive and objectionable odour, unquote, by the 31st of January 2022. And the odour is undoubtedly still offensive and objectionable. Some in the community use much stronger language. One resident told RNZ, quote, it's like silage and dead animals mixed together, unquote. Another told the press quite recently that it is, quote, vile and putrid. But whatever terms we use to describe it, what is not in doubt is that council must fulfil its obligation. So clearly the facility is not yet up to scratch. Between December last year and this July, the Living Earth facility had 87 notices of non-compliance against it. These are the result probably of a vigilant community reporting their justified concerns, but the council must do better for them. And people really shouldn't be made to feel like they're locked into their own homes because of the smell. They shouldn't be prevented from doing simple things like playing in the garden, opening windows on a hot day because of a council-owned facility. People shouldn't be prevented from living in their communities because of a council-owned smell. So the second point I want to make is that the topic of the stench that comes up, it comes up time and time again, particularly when I'm out and about in Bromley and Woolston communities. And I know that many of you would have heard the same clear messages from the community on several occasions over and over again. But I really want to dispel the myth, should it exist, that this is a small number of residents complaining. I've attended meetings and events in Woolston, Bromley, and actually surrounding areas, and on completely unrelated issues, completely unrelated topics. And it's surprising how many times inevitably the conversation returns to this issue. It is deeply and widely felt, and it's not just Bromley. It is Woolston, and actually there's residents associations and groups throughout the electorate who are really concerned about this, and they're willing to support and do what they can to lend their voice to this issue. So I'm here today to add my voice to theirs. I urge the council to investigate moving the facility away from residential communities. I believe this is the best option for the community in the long term. Now, the council, I believe, must take a long-term view of this problem. There's been a smell in Bromley, caused by other council facilities in the area for decades. The community has had to put up with odour issues for a very long time. And I don't think that they should have to wait any longer than today for a decision to show them that you're willing to at least get the ball rolling in the right direction and look towards a long-term solution. And while the stench is something, is not something that any community should have to learn to live with, I do acknowledge that you've tried to mitigate the smell by redeveloping the plant itself and working around the problem. But this doesn't address the root of the problem, that the plant is in a residential area. It's still too close to homes, too close to schools, and too close to communities. And it kind of brings me to my third point. And to be really frank, there's a lack of trust in this community in any mitigation plan at this late stage, after all these years, having been told time and time again that there was no problem. So there's a real lack of trust that redeveloping isn't just tinkering around the edges and it won't actually fix the problem. And to be even more frank, this community has been gaslit and they deserve the best solution, not a solution that may or may not simply limp up to the mere compliance level. This has been going on for too long. The community also deserves some closure on this issue, and moving the plant represents a proper opportunity to do just that. So that's essentially all I want to say. Again, I want to reiterate that this is it's an issue that's been going on for far too long. It's an issue where a community have been told they're wrong for far too long, only to find out that their concerns were valid. It's not confined to a small number of people. It's an issue that has grown, and even if people aren't directly affected, they're concerned about it and they're willing to lend their voice and lend their support to supporting this community. And that is essentially the three points that I wanted to make. So if anybody had any questions, I'm happy to take any questions. Otherwise, I am also happy to leave early and allow you to get through all these depositions quicker.
Thank you very much, Tracy. Does anyone have any questions? Sam McDonald and Yanni Johansson.
Yeah, thanks very much, Tracy, for coming or zooming in for this. It's useful to get your perspective. Look, I was just wondering, you talked a lot about local leadership and I guess, you know, the council's ability to respond. Do you think this would have been resolved better had it been a central government-run facility?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball to make that assumption, but the point is it is a council responsibility. And, you know, but there's some options, and I can see that Yanni's got his hand up, and he probably wants to look at sort of some fast-track consenting sort of issues. But there's no reason to assume that there's not elements of this that central government couldn't be involved in.
Yeah, okay, so we may be able to explore funding through the Ministry for the Environment.
Well, I think it's I think that today is potentially an exciting day for this issue. Whenever we're confronted with this issue, it's generally revolves or is stems from a whole lot of kind of hurt and misery. And today represents an opportunity to actually look forward. And, you know, I don't know what the result could be, and it's certainly it's a council decision and it's a council responsibility, but there's no reason to assume that this couldn't be a positive means by which to look toward the future in terms of what this plant and what this sort of processing looks like.
Yeah, and I guess it'd be wrong of me not to miss an opportunity having a senior Labor MP here. Will you be advocating for us to be able to opt out of the water reforms?
I missed that last bit, sorry.
Oh, will you be advocating for us to
Thank
be able to opt
you,
out
Dan,
of the water
for reforms? Never let a chance go by, but it's not relevant to the item that you're considering.
A little bit out of sorry.
Thank you very kindly. Thank you. Yanni.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your deputation and for raising the concern that the community has raised. I just had two questions. One was, given that government's looking to reform the RMA, is there an ability to look at lessons learnt from consenting around these sorts of activities to inform any changes that to get better protection for the community? Because clearly at the heart of this has been the way in which it was consented, not mitigating the issues that it caused.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it would be really remiss for this, not to feature in that thinking. Yeah, absolutely.
And then just the second question was in regards to working with central government. Obviously, there's a number of mechanisms around potential consenting processes and also funding. What do you think the best way for council is to engage with central government over the next 6 months to look at a joint solution, or to at least make sure that we can look at all the options available for progressing it?
Well, I think in the first instance, it would be remiss not to look at, should that be the decision and should that be the direction that's chosen, not to look at fast-track consenting. There's no reason, not to look at that as an avenue. The fast-track process is there to be used. The Act itself envisaged that the process being used if there's a strong case for job creation, if there's public benefit, and it would be quicker than going through that usual sort of RMA process. So there's no guarantee, obviously, but I think, it would be sensible for council to ask staff to look into those options here. And in terms of funding, above my pay grade, I'm afraid, Yanni, but there is, this is a council responsibility, and it's probably unlikely to be centrally, to attract central government funding to achieve this. But, as I said, going back to that consenting process, I think, the job creation component of that, possibly might open up some other avenues as well in terms of funding.
Thank you.
No other questions?
Thank you very much for your time. Sorry, I forgot to unmute myself, so I was mouthing off without saying anything. So,
thank you so much.
A lot of my colleagues will appreciate that, but thank you very much for your time and energy that you've put into this issue. It's much appreciated, and I'm sure your constituents appreciate it too. So, thank you. All right, team. I'm going to take just a short break. In fact, why don't we adjourn the meeting until 11:45? That gives us 10 minutes, time for a cup of tea, and we'll see you back here in 10 minutes. So thanks very much.